I'm Kevin Busarow with Oberwerk, and today we're going to talk about what to look for when buying a binocular. Let's start with the two most important parameters, and those are magnification and objective size. So this binocular says 8x42, X standing for magnification. We don't say 8x42, we say 8x42. So this binocular has 8x magnification, and the objective lenses, which are the lenses that gather light at the opposite end, are 42 millimeters in diameter. Magnification is going to determine field of view, or the actual area that we're able to take in. We're talking about objective size. We're talking about the amount of light that the binocular is able to gather. The larger objectives, which might be desirable for astronomy, where you're trying to gather as much light as possible, the bigger you go, the heavier that binocular is going to be, and it might be to the point where you're going to have to mount it. So there's two ways to look at field of view. We can measure it in degrees. If we think about a circle of 360 degrees, and the area we're able to take in is a pie slice of, say, 5 degrees, which for this 12x50 binocular, it's a 5-degree field of view. There's another way to measure field of view, and that's how many yards wide is it at 1,000 yards? So if we're looking out 1,000 yards, what's the width of our field of view? And in this case, it's 101 yards. The choice of magnification partly has to do with, do you want to take in a large scene, or do you want to concentrate on a smaller object and bring it in as close as possible, sacrificing field of view to do that? There's another field of view specification called AFOV, or apparent field of view. What this means, well, the true field of view in this case is 5 degrees. The apparent field of view is how much of that peripheral vision is it actually using. Some binoculars are rather narrow in that regard. They have almost a tunnel vision effect. Anything down around 50 degrees or less AFOV is going to give you kind of a tunnel vision effect. So look for a wider apparent field of view. It'll give you more of that picture window feeling. In this case, it's about 70 degrees. Another specification is called the IPD range. That stands for interpupillary distance range. That's referring to the eyepiece spacing. So everybody's eyes are a little different. We want to make sure that that binocular is going to match our eye spacing. Children with their smaller faces can't use most binoculars. They simply cannot bring the eyepieces close enough together for them to see through both sides at the same time. And you'll often notice when you hand a binocular to a child, they end up looking through it like a telescope because that's the only way they're going to see something. We do have a special binocular called the 6.5x32 Explore Series. It's our smallest binocular, but it has the unique capability to go extra narrow on the eyepiece spacing. So while most binoculars can get as narrow as about 57 millimeters, this one can go all the way down to 51. So even the youngest child can use this binocular and see through both sides. But it also goes as wide as any other binocular, so any adult can use this binocular as well. The other binocular that can go extra narrow, surprisingly, are the binocular telescopes. They also have a very narrow minimum IPD of 50 millimeters. So again, the youngest child, people that have eyes that are very close together, can use a binocular telescope. It also goes out past 80, so any adult can use this as well. So another feature to look for is the binocular waterproof? You may not think binocular that's going to be used for astronomy, that it would matter if it's waterproof or not. If the binocular is waterproof, that means we can fill it with dry nitrogen. And that is important for astronomy. Those nights when the temperatures drop, if we had air inside this binocular and the temperatures drop, water could start to condense on the inside of the binocular. And that's a bad thing because while it will eventually clear out, it could take days. So if you have internal condensation, you're done with your observing. All Oberwerk binoculars are waterproof and they have a nitrogen fill, mostly for that reason. So there's never internal condensation. So when we're talking about coatings, there's some terminology. The first is coated, and that simply means that one or more surfaces have a single coat of anti-reflection coating. With a uncoated lens, when light strikes that lens, approximately 5% would be reflected away. It would be lost. And that doesn't sound too bad. But if you think about a typical binocular that has multiple lenses throughout, prism surfaces, and then multiple lens elements in the eyepieces, that adds up to a lot of air-to-glass surfaces. If each of those surfaces is losing 5%, you're going to end up with less than half of the light that's hitting the objective lenses, actually making it out the back end of the binocular. Today, high-quality binoculars use multi-coatings. They cut down on the reflection to the point where we can get it down to less than 0.5% per surface. On a high-quality binocular with, say, 20 air-to-glass surfaces, we might have approximately 90% efficiency, or only a 10% loss due to reflection. The other thing that can happen is if light is being reflected and scattered, that can cause a loss of contrast. So a binocular with excellent, very efficient coatings is also going to have very good contrast because there's very little light that is scattered inside the binocular. Then there's multi-coated versus fully multi-coated. Multi-coated could mean that maybe just the outside surfaces, this objective lens coating and this eyepiece coating, are multi-coated. You will often see that on inexpensive binoculars. They will just have coated surfaces that you can see on the outside, but internally uncoated, therefore highly inefficient and great loss of contrast. All Oberwerk binoculars are what is known as fully multi-coated. That means that each and every air-to-glass surface has multi-coating on it. So that's going to be your highest efficiency. You want to look for a binocular that is FMC or fully multi-coated. Speaking of coatings, there are types of multi-coatings, and we use a special type called broadband. And what does that mean? Well, you think about the range of visible light as wavelengths from 400 nanometers up to 700 nanometers. How efficient is that multi-coating across that entire visible range? And what you typically find is maybe in the middle of that range, the multi-coating's highly efficient, maybe a 0.5%, but as we go out toward the extremes of the visible range, the multi-coating gets very inefficient. Now we're starting to see high levels of reflectivity out at the ends of the bandwidth. So broadband multi-coating means that the coating is efficient across the entire range of the visible spectrum. Should be close to a flat line. That's a broadband multi-coating. So all Oberwerk binoculars are fully broadband multi-coated. So every multi-coating is a broadband multi-coating, and it's on every air-to-glass surface throughout the binocular. Another thing to look at are the glass types that are used in a binocular. Now, most binoculars use standard, what's called crown flint glass, standard optical glass. And that's great. It's been around forever. We get very high quality images with standard crown flint glass. The problem we have with standard optical glass is something called chromatic aberration or false color fringing. The place where you're going to see that is if you look at a tree branch off in the distance. When you look at the fine twigs in that tree branch, they're going to have purple halos. Again, that's chromatic aberration or false color fringing. If we're a serious bird watcher and we're trying to identify a bird based on colors, we don't want to see colors that aren't there. So bird watchers in particular are willing to pay extra for exotic glasses that minimize or eliminate that false color fringing. All of our bird watching binoculars, that would be our Sport Series, Sport HD2, Sport ED, all of these binoculars use what's called ED glass, and it stands for extra low dispersion. And that glass eliminates chromatic aberration up to a certain magnification. And for these hand holdables, we can say that it effectively eliminates all chromatic aberration for the relatively low magnifications they're running. Now, when we get up to higher powers, like our binocular telescopes, chromatic aberration increases with brightness of object and also magnification. So our binocular telescopes, they use exotic glass, either ED, extra low dispersion, or what we call SD, super low dispersion. ED glass at the high magnifications that we run in binocular telescopes, it's going to remove most chromatic aberration, maybe 85-90%. If you're looking for it, you'll still see a trace of it on the edge of the moon or other bright objects. We do have a step beyond that, and that is SD, or super low dispersion glass. And SD glass can completely eliminate false color fringing up to the maximum recommended magnification of the binocular, which in this case, the BT100 XL-SD can go to 80 times magnification. So even at 80 times magnification, we're not gonna see chromatic aberration. So if we need to mount our binocular, either because the magnification is too high to hold still or it's just too big and heavy, we can use a tripod, or a nice alternative to the tripod is a monopod. And I have our monopod right here. And it has the L adapter already attached, so all I need to do is attach the binocular. Get enough height, and I'm ready to go. This monopod has what we call a grip action ball head. So it has a trigger on it. We just squeeze it to reposition the head to any angle. These are great for solo astronomy. The only downside to using a monopod is if you're trying to share the view with somebody, it's impossible to get this on target and then step away from it and have somebody else take a look. You'll lose the target. So in that situation, a tripod is much better because you can set the tripod on an object and walk away from the binocular and it won't lose the target. If you need a tripod, Oberwerk has some unique tripods. The thing that's different about Oberwerk aluminum tripods are the height. Most camera tripods on the market, they simply don't go tall enough to get a binocular like this overhead where you can stand underneath it and look up. So our tripods are made to go extra tall, from the least expensive, the model 3000, up to the 5000. They all have plenty of height to get that binocular overhead so you can stand up and get underneath it and look straight up at the night sky. We also build our hardwood tripods right here. It's the TR3 hardwood tripod. We make them out of solid maple and solid walnut. So they're 100% American made right here. So they're super sturdy. They have lots of height. They have a patented feature called slip stop that prevents accidental leg slippage and possible collapse of the tripod. There's really nothing else on the market that has the capacity and the beauty of the TR3 tripod for anywhere near its price. And it's the ultimate mount for any of our binocular telescopes. So the other thing most people are looking at, of course, is price when choosing a binocular. And we have various product families in the Oberwerk product line, starting with our entry level, which is called the Explore series. These are our lowest price binoculars. They have all the high quality features you're looking for. We didn't cut any corners there. You know, they're fully broadband multi-coated. They're waterproof and nitrogen filled. They don't have the exotic glass. They have standard optical glass, but they're a very high quality view for a very modest price. The next step up in our line is the Deluxe Series. This is the 842 Explore and the 842 Deluxe. It's just a bit better build quality on the Deluxe, optical quality a little bit better. Then from there, we go up to the SE Series, stands for Special Edition. Now the Special Edition uses that exotic glass, that ED glass. So this binocular eliminates chromatic aberration. It has even higher level of quality on the optics, sharper to the edge than the lesser models. Next up in the series, the Ultra series. This is our top of the line in our mid-size binoculars. You can see they're very rugged, ruggedly built, yet relatively lightweight because it's magnesium alloy construction. Our highest level of optical quality. And then over in our Sport optics, the Sport HD2, these are our entry level in the birdwatching binoculars, birdwatching and hiking. They do have ED glass, so we didn't cut any corners there because birders don't want to see false color. And then the next step up, which is our top of the line birding binocular, is the Sport ED. Main difference is build quality. For example, the controls here are rubber over plastic, the focuser and the right side diopter. On the Sport ED, it's red anodized because those are aluminum. The body on the Sport ED is magnesium alloy, where it's aluminum on the HD2. So we talked about the various product families within the Oberwerk line. Of course, at the very top are the XL series binocular telescopes, which are the ultimate for a couple of reasons. First of all, they have the top of the line glass, either ED or SD glass. They have 45 degree viewing, which is important when looking up. When we look up, this is so much easier on our neck to look at a 45 degree angle through the binocular. And finally, and maybe most importantly, they have interchangeable eyepieces. And on handheld binoculars, it's the eyepiece that's determining magnification, but we can't change that. On a binocular telescope, we can. These eyepieces come out and we can plug in different eyepieces to obtain different magnification. So by pulling out the 14 millimeter eyepieces and plugging in 7 millimeter eyepieces, I've just doubled the magnification. So now I'm operating at 80 times magnification. And that's game changing. That's what makes things like planets and even the moon really interesting, when you can magnify that highly. And even if you're using these just for daylight, to be able to bring in a ship really closely, it's game changing.